Good evening and welcome to Bloop Radio. This is Alex Banks with my Digging Deep show. Today I'm going to be taking you through some of my musical history and digging deep into my career, different tunes that I've listened to pretty much since I was like 10 years old that have influenced me and that have kind of shaped my musical journey along the way. So first track I'm going to play for you is by a English band called Osric Tentacles, and the track is called Sploosh. This was introduced to me by my brother around when I was sort of 10 years old. I was starting to get really into electric guitar music, things like Guns N' Roses, Metallica, and I was introduced to this band, and it was like roaring guitar solos, mad time signature changes, really great musicianship, but like crazy synthesizers. And it was the first time I'd really been introduced to synthesized sounds, and I thought it was really cool at the time, and it still is pretty cool. So this is Sploosh by Osric Tentacles. Don't Boosh by Osric Tentacles. And yeah, really love some of the synth sounds in that. I mean, that came out around 1990 and it's really forward thinking for its time. And yeah, I think a band listening to them really sort of influenced me in terms of incorporating synthesizers into my music and giving me that excitement for sounds, thinking like, how the hell did he make that? I'm wanting to find out. So next track is Lusty by Lamb. And I was listening to them in 95. I remember being at school and a bunch of mates and myself going around someone's house to hang out at one lunchtime, and somebody had this album and put it on. I remember thinking, like, what the hell is this? I've never heard anything like this before. Like, really cool, chopped up electronic beats, really forward-thinking production, but really intimate, breathy vocals from Lou Rhodes. And I remember it really just kind of stayed with me at the time and really made an impact, and I think, again, shaped the way my sound sort of developed, trying to make really forward-thinking sort of electronic dance music, but whilst incorporating songs and working with vocalists. So this is Lusty by Lamb. Lusty by Lamb. Really cool track. And yeah, like that and Portishead and Massive Attack and a lot of the other kind of trip hop stuff that was coming out around the time, I think really played a big part in shaping how my sound developed. So the next track I'm going to play is by Eat Static, who are actually a spin-off group from Osric Tentacles, who I played you earlier in the show. And I think this is quite significant for me because the Osric Tentacles stuff was more kind of band guitar based music with electronics and synthesizers involved. And once the mid-90s came around, I started to get more into my dance music and electronic stuff. And Eat Static was kind of like a dance music breakaway. A couple of the guys from the band left and started this group. And I remember seeing them at Glastonbury a couple of times in various states of consciousness and being pretty blown away by what I was hearing. But this particular track is called Bony Incus. And I remember having it on tape. I think I'd recorded it off a friend, or maybe my brother gave it to me or something. Not an original tape, like, you know, probably a third hand recording or something. It was the worst quality, but it was this really cool, like, psychedelic kind of jungle track. And this was like 95, 96. I'd never heard anything like this before. I remember playing this tape over and over until eventually the tape chewed up. And I remember spending ages messing around with the tape, pulling it to bits and trying to wind it back on to get it to work. So I really wanted to listen to this tune. Anyway, some years later, my sister Lil very kindly tracked it down on vinyl and bought me a copy. So yeah, this is Bony Incus, and I think it's called the Shapehead Remix. So give it a listen. Eat Static and Phony Incas, kind of cool mental jungle vibes. So next track I'm going to play is Movements by Roots Maneuver. This is from a brand new Second Hand album. And this is really significant for me because it came out around early 2000s, I think. And I was at university at the time, University of Westminster in London, doing music. I was focusing on music production. And this particular track, although it's from brand new Second Hand, it came as part of the Ninja Zen Cuts 10-year anniversary box set, which one of my flatmates had on vinyl. I remember sitting around for hours, like listening to this whole new Ninja Tune collection, and being really inspired by it at the time. Like Roots Maneuver's grooves in particular, I just found really organic. Like the quantize was kind of all over the place. It wasn't kind of locked at all, and it just sounded really fresh at the time. But also listening to a lot of like Amon Tobin and Cold Cut, and Hextatic and DJ Vadim, and all this cool kind of like hip hop crossover electronica that was coming out on Ninja at the time, and it was really really ear opening for me. So this track I'm going to play is I'd say it's called Movements. I was really like wasn't particularly into UK hip hop at the time, but had started working with a few rappers that were based in North London, just doing little bits of recording here and there. Like a friend of mine was a hip hop producer, and I was just kind of helping him out like with some of his sort of mixing, as I was kind of learning how to mix at the time, and then ended up working with some rappers. It was a really good experience for me, and kind of opened my ears to a lot of the hip hop stuff that was coming out. And but Roots Maneuver in particular was like something about his lyrics that's very inspiring, very imaginative and very poetic. And this track really resonated with me.
The light man said stay in the light.
So we stay. Alrighty, okay. This is a little ditty that we refer to as the movement. Movements of the mind mass. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Roots Fire Discotheque. On the turntables we have DJ MK, Kilburn's Finest. And on the microphone, Roderick Maneuver. All the way from the southwest, with time to get off my chest. I bring you 10 ton girl to this homegrown rain. Bonify what you hear, tis the sound of pain. But the pain leads to gain, so we dare not stagnate, we elevate to the next state. Motion divine, glisten like crystal ball, and stand tall with this knowledge and overstanding. Enterprise landing, bringing them new brands above. Yes, we come proper with potencies. Ain't no blood in my body, it's liquid soul in my vein. I dance on the thin line of sane and the range. It's all crisp when we get neatly in the cypher, trapped like kidney to the pipe of the bind. As this natural mystic flows through the air, the lessons of life become crystal clear. Position of my vision is ito, separating sharks from the blessed is vital. Now I can smell them rats coming from a mile around the corner. Once I might warn ya, twice on the catch cuff. No, we won't stop, rebuke thee. You satanics, you fools can't recruit me. Not now while there's
movements for men, typhoons broom, strong ankles side them or silk coast shoe. Movements for men, typhoons broom, strong ankles side them or silk coast shoe. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right.
As played by the Roots Fire Discotheque, the Psycho Aqua Doodoo Sound. I slap the bacon out your mouth, dance upon your sonic, rolling with your regiment. God bless army, how the hell you're going to stop them tides from steady coming? Running, catching tune with the element, set speed, we proceed. Traction for action, hot 125, Government boots get that to the side. Two rank, two snide now. All that they try to disguise, I can still recognize. Weak heart works when I see it. Weak heart disciples keep weak heart's friends. I always had a hate for what their weak hearts defend. But if being for that crack, ain't no one to tax. Who runs back home and smokes a brown bag of seed? Best believe that these times are treacherous. And I know not how else I'm supposed to act, but stand close to close the roots fine. See me getting dead with that two-step shuffle. Haggling, I hustle for the cause. Raining with that roots-type terror. Frigging up your weak heart to error. We build, move, and prove that we don't suffer fools. Movements for back, typhoons brew. Strong ankles shy, they will still get you. Movements for back, typhoons brew. Strong ankles shy, they will still coast you. Yeah. Right, it's the roots for back, let's go. Typhoons move, strong ankles shy, them will still come true. Movements for back, typhoons brew, strong ankles shy, them will still come true.
Movements by Roots Maneuver. So next track I'm going to play is Derek May, Strings of Life. And again, this is from my uni days, what is significant to me. In my last year of uni, I was writing an essay called The Effects of Commercialization on the Artistic Value of Dance Music. And I didn't really go to university to kind of study academia, or went to like to learn how to make albums or like develop my production skills and to make contacts and to network and all that kind of thing, which I did. But I'd say, like, in terms of what I got from university, in terms of like direct teaching, I think musicology and sociology and kind of like theory of what art is and how it fits into the world was something that I didn't really go there expecting to learn, but ended up studying quite a lot. And I remember in my last year at uni doing this dissertation and like kind of cramming it into the last couple of months for the deadline, doing loads of reading about stuff from like Walter Benjamin, about like the concept of art. And it was really fascinating reading stuff from like, you know, like really early in the kind of 1900s, people writing about how art would be perceived in the future and how media would develop long before we had, you know, MP3s or CDs or anything like that. So it's really interesting, and I was really doing a lot of research and a lot of thinking about how I kind of fitted into the world as a musician and as an artist, and what the art I created actually kind of meant in the grand scheme of things. And it was really frying my brain. I was getting like hardly any sleep, kind of working towards this deadline, trying to get this essay finished. And it was just like, it's like a kind of tree growing. Like the more I thought about it, the more things there were to think about, as it were. Like the deeper you get into a subject, you realize how deep it is and how many different ways you can go with it. And anyway, I remember handing in the dissertation and then going out, or maybe actually think about it, maybe it's like a week before we had to hand it in, and I kind of almost finished it. And we went to see Mr. Scruff do a one of his all-nighters at the Forum in Kentish Town. And somewhere deep in the night, like my brain was kind of going all over the place, having a really good dance, really getting lost in my thoughts, really lost in the moment. And it was the first time I heard this track, Derek May, Strings of Life, which obviously is a huge dance anthem. And I remember hearing this track, and somehow, like, as this track kind of came in, I felt like a conclusion of all these thoughts that I've been thinking of, you know, what is art and kind of how do I fit into the world, and just kind of had this real, like, deep sense of purpose as an artist. And, yeah, I mean, it's kind of hard to explain in in a relatively short amount of words, but at the time this track just really connected with me. I remember thinking like, yeah, this is what I want to do. I want to make electronic music. This is my art. I'm going to be an artist. And when I leave university, this is what I'm going to do when I continue my career. So yeah, it meant a lot to me at the time. So here it is. Strings of Life, absolutely amazing tune. So next track I'm going to play is Hands by Fortep. Now this tune, I remember listening to it after university. I left London, I moved back to the countryside in Buckinghamshire where I grew up, and lived with my mum for a couple of years, basically whilst I kind of continued getting my production chops together. I've been working on an album towards the end of university that I didn't actually get finished, and I was thinking, oh, I'll move back to the countryside for a little while to, just for a few months till I get this record finished. And about 2 years later, I think I was finishing the record, but, you know, that's how it goes. But my production came on a huge amount in that time. I was living like this crazy nocturnal lifestyle, going to bed at like midday and kind of... going to bed like usually sort of 7 or 8 o'clock and kind of getting up at like 4 o'clock in the afternoon most days, and in the winter just like basically waking up, seeing the sunset, and then living a night of darkness, making music in my studio. So I can't really do that anymore, but it was fun at the time, and I feel like I learned a huge amount. But anyway, around that time, I just got my first iPod. I think we were on to like third generation by that point. And I had this Fortet album on there, and Hands was the first track. And I remember listening to this, like going for walks around the village and like going for walks in the forest and down by the river, like listening to a lot of Fortet. And I really loved the kind of organic sample-based production, and it just sounded really fresh at the time. It sounded really warm, it sounded really kind of inviting, but like there was so much detail and kind of cool beats and really cool vibes. So yeah, I was really into it. I think it's an amazing track, so here it is. The Keeper featuring Andrea Triana, and it's my remix. Back then, this was around 2012, I think I did this. And basically, like, I'd been working on music for a few years, living down in Brighton, and I had just moved into this little studio, which was right in the middle of town. And I was sharing with a guy called Sam Watts, Maxi Sound System. There's a whole bunch of other producers that had these kind of different rooms. They're almost like cells in this kind of like concrete rabbit warren that kind of ran underneath the ground. And it was pretty dirty, pretty scummy place, but it was pretty cool to have my first like proper studio for the first time. So anyway, like, I kind of reached the point in my career where I've been living in Brighton for a while. I'd got a bunch of tunes together and I was really trying to work out like how I could get these to some labels, how I could sort of move forward. And by chance, like, ended up bumping into an old acquaintance, like old friend of mine from uni, who introduced me to a guy he was working for, who ended up becoming a manager, and basically explained to him like that I've got a few tunes together, like, how do I get them to labels? Like, what's the next step for me, basically? I remember him saying, like, well, what are your dream labels? Like, who would you want to kind of work with? Who would you want to approach? I said, well, Ninja Tune's one of them. And he's like, well, actually, I've got a connection there. And so anyway, he ended up like chatting to some guys at Ninja who were really interested in what I was doing. They didn't feel that the tracks that I made at the time were quite right for the label, but they basically a few weeks later kind of got back to me and said that we're doing a remix album for Bonobo's Black Sands. Do you think Alex would be interested in doing a remix? And for me, this was like a dream come true. I mean, Bonobo was a big influence over my sound, particularly back then when I was making some slightly more downbeat stuff, and basically given the opportunity to like remix one of my favorite artists. I was like, wow, what an amazing opportunity to drop on my lap. So I remember spending a month like basically working on this one track and driving myself nuts, just listening to it over and over again, like refining the production. I remember starting like three different ideas before I actually kind of progressed with the one that ended up being released. And I remember the first one I did was quite sort of hip-hoppy. The second one was kind of like, I can't remember the style, but I remember really trying to push myself forward and trying to do something new with the sound. And not long before then, I remember I'd been out to see, it was Marla was playing at a club in London, I can't remember which one now, and I was with a mate of mine, Mikey Bodium. Hi Mikey, if you're listening. And it was actually his birthday. We'd seen a bunch of other DJs play that night, and I think it got to like 4 a.m. Marla was about to come on. I didn't really know Marla's sound at the time, but my mate was like, look, you've got to listen to this DJ. And it got to like 4 a.m, I was pretty tired, and some of the guys were gonna leave. I was like, look man, I'm gonna head home now. And he's like, no, you cannot leave. You have to listen to this set. So I did, I stayed, and it absolutely blew me away. And I can't remember any particular tune that stuck with me, but I remember leaving the club and the next day or the day after, like going to the studio to work on this remix, and something about the kind of dubstepy, heavy bass vibe of like his whole set kind of stayed with me. And when I started working on this Bonobo remix, whilst it certainly isn't dubstep, there was something about the bass heaviness and the kind of feel of some of the music that Mara had been playing that night that really influenced me at the time and kind of shaped how it came out. So yeah, and it was my first kind of big proper release, really. It's first track that I had released on vinyl. Yeah, it was quite a mad time for me. So this is The Keeper, and it's the Banks remix. Before I was calling myself Alex Banks, this was just Banks. So thank you. That was the Keeper Banks remix. So next track I'm going to play is by Moderax called Number 22. And I feel this track's really significant for me because it was the first time that I'd heard Moderax music. I was at a festival called Playground Festival. It was halfway between Brighton and London. I was DJing there and I remember chatting to some mates, and they seen me DJ and obviously knew the music that I was playing, and we're chatting about music and said, have you heard of Monkey Sound Records? Have you heard of Moderat? And I hadn't at the time. They're like, look, you've got to listen to this. You're going to absolutely love it. So I remember them putting some headphones on, saying like, look, you've got to listen to this now. And I think the track they played was Number 22. And I was absolutely blown away by it. And it's the first time really that I've been introduced to kind of the Berlin sound and Berlin techno, but it was like techno production, but with different beats and different rhythms. It wasn't just kind of straight up horse to the floor stuff. And there were vocals in there and all sorts of like really kind of melancholic, sort of slightly dystopian textures. And absolutely loved it. And obviously at the time I didn't realize that, you know, a couple of years later I'd be releasing on Monkey Sound Records and supporting Moderat. So I feel like this track kind of marked the beginning of quite a significant journey and part of my career. So this is Number 22. number 22 by Moderat. So the next track I'm going to play is Open Eye Signal by John Hopkins. Absolutely love this track, and I remember hearing this for the first time in I think it was the Electro Works in London, and I knew of John Hopkins, but I hadn't really heard much of his music sort of by that point. I remember seeing him live and just being absolutely blown away, and listening to his production over and over again, and just it just sounds so fresh, like his approach to kind of composition, his approach to production. Like if you listen to the mix down in this track, like it's really kind of squashed, really smashed together, but everything just has its place and all the layers just work together perfectly. But I remember I was listening to this a lot kind of not long after I'd finished Illuminate, which came out in 2014, and I could definitely tell that listening to this album was going to influence sort of how my sound was going to develop sort of, you know, in the years to come. And very poignantly, I remember seeing him at Coco in London, and I don't know what capacity is there, maybe like 2,000 capacity venue or 3,000 or something like that. And I remember being up on the balcony looking down over the venue when he played Open Eye Signal, and it was a sold out gig. There's like thousands of people going absolutely nuts. And it made me think of a phrase from somebody at a label who, like, really cool label and really respectable guy, but like he was basically sort of speaking on behalf of the label, saying, look, you know, we've been listening to your music, we like your sound, but no one's going to listen to 8-minute techno electronica epics, which is kind of what I was into making at the time, particularly with tracks like Initiate and some other tunes I was doing. And seeing John Hopkins playing at Coco, playing like this like 8-minute kind of techno electronica epic, I was thinking, actually, I think that guy from that label's wrong. I think there's a market for this kind of music. And it was really touching to see somebody performing something that sounded like, to my ears, so amazing, like real art, really forward thinking production, and seeing that there's a real audience for that music. So it's an amazing track. Here it is.
Thank you.
So next track I'm going to play is a band called Vessels, and it's my remix of a track called Elliptic. Now, Vessels got in touch with me, I think it was 2015. They've been big fans of my record Illuminate, and were looking for some remixes at the time. So they gave me a shout and said, look, you know, we'd love it if you'd be up for doing one. And yeah, I really loved their sound, like a lot of their harmony, a lot of their textures were kind of quite similar to my music in some ways, but with a live band context. And I remember before I started working on it, going to Block Festival in Butlins, can't remember where it was now, but like if any of you have been to these places, it's pretty surreal having like thousands of ravers kind of in a like weird sort of traditional English holiday park, but it was a lot of fun. And I remember one of the highlights of the weekend was seeing Jeff Mills play. And as a lot of you probably already know, like his main thing is focused around his 909. He's like an absolute wizard of it. The way he works his drum machine as an instrument, particularly like the end of his set where he just plays like the last 15 minutes, completely captivating an entire room just with one drum machine, is pretty awesome. And so anyway, not really comparable, but I just got a Korg Volker Beats drum machine, like a tiny little sort of 808 sort of thing, which I've still got, and it's still a lot of fun to play with. But I remember starting work on this remix and being really inspired by Jeff Mills and the way he used this drum machine, and was just playing around with this little Volker, coming up with some really cool beats on it, and that kind of formed the basis of this remix. Yeah, and that kind of also began the beginning of a friendship with Vessels. I ended up playing some shows with them up in Leeds and also down in Brighton, and actually turned out to be how myself and my partner Maya, who's sat there on the sofa over there, ended up meeting, and 5 years later we're still together. Yeah, music has an interesting way of playing parts in all aspects of our lives. So anyway, I'm just going to put the record on if I can get this one off.
Thank you.
as Vessels Elliptic, my remix. So the next track I'm going to play is Future Sound of London, Papua New Guinea. Now this track doesn't really fit into the timeline, but as we're near the end of the show, I really wanted to kind of round it off with this. This was one of those tracks that always just kind of uplifted me at the end of the night. I'm not quite sure why, but you know, it was the end of my DJ sets for years, or like if I got back from a night out, been putting on some tunes, this just always seemed like a really fitting end to it. So yeah, it's absolutely amazing tune. The original is obviously absolutely incredible too, but the high contrast drum and bass remix that I'm gonna play now has just always stayed with me for years. So this is Papua New Guinea, Future Sound London, high contrast remix. Amazing tune. When that vocal comes in, like, I could never help but smile. It's just such a good vibe. So almost at the end of the show, the last track I'm going to play for you is a track by myself called Spiraling. It's a Max Cooper remix. As I'm sure some of you know, I recently released, a year ago, yesterday, released an album called Beneath the Surface on Max Cooper's Mesh label. Max and I have been in touch for years. We collaborated on a track before and really appreciated each other's music. And Max's music has been quite a big influence over my sound. I really love his kind of warm, organic sounding production, but like really kind of amazingly technical, intricate detail. And just love the vibe of his music, and it's had a big influence over me over the years. So releasing on his label, getting a remix by Max of one of my tracks has been a real kind of significant point in my career, and really pleased with the way it's all come together. So this is the last track I'm going to play for you. It's a Spiraling Max Cooper remix. That's it from me. Thanks ever so much for tuning in and listening. It's been a pleasure to see you on a dig deeper show, and actually it's been really fun to listen to a lot of tunes that have really meant something to me over the years that I haven't actually listened to for a long time. So yeah, thanks for listening. If you want to check out www.alexbanksmusic.co.uk or find me on Facebook, Alex Banks Music, or Twitter or Instagram, anything like that, check out any of the tunes I've been working on. Join the mailing list, got lots of releases coming up, or just come and say hi. So thanks a lot for listening. Catch you later.